My name is Sean Cullen. I'll give you a brief introduction of myself. Right now, I work as a full-time crisis clinician at Overlook Medical Center, so I do the crisis evaluations. Yeah, down in Summit, yep. Yeah, so I do the crisis evaluations down there at Overlook in the emergency room. Prior to that, I worked part per diem at Chilton Medical Center, down the road in Chilton there, and for a number of years, I worked at St. Clair's Hospital. I'm still there from time to time. I've worked in behavioral health for about just a little over 14 years now. My background, you know, I am not a certified alcohol drug counselor. I'm not an LCADC, which is a licensed certified alcohol drug counselor. I have worked with numerous individuals with substance abuse issues and co-occurring issues. I've also done countless amounts of evaluations of individuals in the emergency department with those similar issues, substance use disorders and co-occurring disorders. So in coming here tonight, when they initially approached me on doing a talk on substance use, I wanted to focus a little bit more on, you know, obviously the family situation with substance use, and also sort of the conceptualization of what a substance use disorder individual is. So in talking about that, I wanted to talk a little bit about what are some of the statistics, not to bore everybody, but the statistics of substance use right now. According to the CDC and SAMHSA, which is sort of the organization for substance abuse and mental illness, they're a national organization from the government who runs a lot of studies, substance use has actually declined in the last 5 years, surprisingly, which seems counterintuitive to all the articles we're seeing in the news. Overall, substance rates have sort of stabilized from ages 12 to 18. I'm talking about adolescents now. Adults is a little different, but from ages 12 to 18, substance use has been has stayed the same for the last 5 years, or decreased in certain areas. The only area that has somewhat increased, surprisingly, is actually MDMA, which is commonly referred to as ecstasy. Heroin use, which is a growing epidemic, obviously, and a huge one in New Jersey. I know West Milford has had a lot of issues over. Yeah, I mean, I still have affiliation with Newbridge Services.
Are you saying just heroin or all opioids?
Opioids overall, I think heroin's coming more to the forefront because the death rate, the overdose death rate, and the death rate has tripled in the state of New Jersey in the last 5 years. We are triple the rate of the national average, actually, for the state.
Wow. New Jersey?
Yeah, which I didn't actually know until I started researching some of this stuff. And those are the findings from the CDC, actually.
So we were the good state.
Oh, that's what it seemed, right? I mean, you think with, comparatively, when you think of states and a bias that we have, and that's something we'll go into a little bit in a little while, but you know, we look at state New Jersey. Obviously, New Jersey has a large wealth gamut in terms of high incomes to low incomes, but we also have a lot of taxes. We pay a lot, so we think a lot of services, but apparently, in terms of the death rate in regards to opiate and heroin overdoses, is exceptionally high. We're one of the highest in the country. Not the highest, but we're in probably top 10. So it's sort of counterintuitive in terms of the substance use has stayed the same in terms of the reported rate, which, you know, statistics can be manipulated, but meanwhile, opiate deaths have really increased. That's why you're seeing so much about opiates and heroin right now, constantly in the newspapers and the initiatives where a lot of the money and funding has been going in the state.
Do you think that the 12 to 18 group, which you said is equal or declined, is because of education starting to equal?
To speak in terms of research, I honestly don't know. To speak in terms of observation, I think there's been a lot more engagement in terms of substance use. I think the way we're perceiving and going after substance use education is changing. You know, when I was a minor, it was stereotypical, just say no to drugs.
Right.
It was a very blanket statement, and don't do drugs, and you know, if you do drugs, you're the famous
dare program.
Yeah, you know, the old, yeah, the eggs in the pan. I mean, I still remember those. Yeah, I mean, maybe they worked. but
you know, this is your brain on
drugs,
right?
Famous, yeah. So I think in a lot of ways, you know, I think there is a change in that. I think the education, and I think also there's a lot more outreach to families in regards to substances. Now, the funny thing with the findings is the largest group of substance use increase is actually 18 to 25-year-olds. So if you look at the statistics, they've been stable, so the people that are hitting into the 18 range for the last 5 years have been relatively stable in terms of increased use. Once they hit 18 to 25, the use actually increases across the board for almost all substances, specifically opiates and heroin. That trend tends to continue until about age 30, and then all substance use starts to tail down. There's a lot of different theories about that. Now, with substance use, statistically speaking, the CADC and SAMHSA again have said that there's two different findings. One said that people, from 2013, the amount of people who had a definitive substance use disorder, which we'll talk about that in a sec, what does that actually mean? Only 0.2% actually received the appropriate level of treatment that they needed. So it's not even one, it's less than 1% of the people who needed the treatment got into the appropriate level of treatment. How they define it, they didn't really say in the article per se, so I'm not sure what they're calling in terms of what they're saying the appropriate level is. The CDC said it was around 11%. So out of the amount of people who had a substance use disorder, only 11% of them are getting treatment for it, or the appropriate level of treatment. So that leaves almost 90% of the people out continued use patterns or failed treatment initiatives.
There aren't enough groups to treat them, too. It's hard to get in, or to keep following
with
additional support groups in
there,
too.
It's exceptionally hard, and I think that's part of something we'll get into a little bit about, you know, our conception of substance use, and then specifically our conception of substance use treatment, and how it's been, in my view, which is my opinion, and obviously if you read, there's tons of research in literature, and everybody has different schools of thought and different, you know, I don't think there's one definitive answer for the problem. And even some of my ideas in the track that I tend to gravitate towards, someone else will say, no, it's not, you know, you're on the wrong tree. So, but I think that there, you know, our concept of treatment is starting to change, but it's been, it's not adequate to what the issues are right now. So now with that, we're talking about, you know, what is a substance use disorder? Obviously, you know, for some people, the American Psychiatric Association changed their criteria a few years back. The manual that we all use called the Diagnostic and Statistic Manual of Mental Illness, DSM, went from a 4 TR to a 5. Sounds relevant, but it's a, for people in the field, it's a big deal. Substance use disorder now is categorized no longer by abuse or dependence. Before, it used to be these two categories. So you could have someone who was abusing a substance, but they weren't physiologically dependent on the substance, so they categorize it as two different things. Now they're saying, well, that doesn't really matter. Now we're looking at the level of use, so is it mild, moderate, or severe? And it's interesting because some of the way it's categorized, for example, alcohol use disorder, a large percentage of the American population can be categorized for alcohol use disorder. So I bring this up because I think it goes into our perception of what addiction is and what substance abuse disorders are. We have this idea that, you know, I mean, if I say to you, what is it, when I say the word addict, what comes to mind for people?
You need it.
You need it physically and emotionally.
Right. And what are the perceptions we have of addicts generally?
Perceptions?
Is it somebody we want to sit with on a bus or walk down the street?
Right.
But it's coming around that it's like a disease because now, before it wasn't accepted that way, don't go near them. But now it's coming around a little bit more with the concept that this is a disease, and what's starting to create more of a harem, and they brought up different ways, like people are in pain and they give them a pharmaceutical with opioids, like
returning soldiers,
or whatever, and then the prescriptions expire a little off of it, and they still feel they need something. They start with the heroin because it's $3.50 or $5 per packet, you know.
Sure, it's much cheaper.
And it's become a disease. A lot of it leads from that.
And that's, I think it's a good point, Graham, because right now, especially with the 18 to 25 and really the 18 to 30 range, one of the largest groups for increase in substance use is actually Caucasians of middle class origin, which typically the stereotypical view was more, and it was historically also somewhat statistically validated. Most substance use, especially substances like heroin and opiates, was more found in inner cities among minority populations. That's now completely changed. So you're seeing young professionals, so to speak, who are educated, who are fairly well levels of income, are now succumbing to substance use disorders at a higher rate than before. Now there's a lot of argument that it could be better statistics are being kept, people are more, you know, there's always an argument, counter argument to these points, but I think the idea is that, you know, with substance use, when we talk about it, I don't like the term addict.
Wait, I'm confused. Yeah. Are you considering substance abuse the same thing as alcohol abuse, or are they two different disorders?
They're kind of, well, substance use is now the term that they're using, right? It's a new hot term. So we're putting everything under that umbrella.
Would that include cigarettes, nicotine?
Technically, it does for certain things. Now, they've categorized it out in terms of, they'll call it nicotine abuse, and now they're even taking statistics on e-cigarette vaping, electric. Yeah, which is a whole nother category we'll touch base on, because there's a lot of things that will be done with those. But substance use, they actually categorize nicotine, cigarettes, tobacco, all that is categorized under the umbrella of substance use disorder. For the purpose of this talk, I'm going to try and focus solely more on the illicit substances. Alcohol is obviously an ongoing issue. And I'm going to speak sort of broadly about all these in a way that kind of, you know, these ideas kind of tie into anyone having issues with any type of substance use. So having said that, and it's a good point, because I think there is a lot of confusion, and we do tend to, there's a stigma associated with different substances. Mm-hmm. You know, if you know, Aunt Fatima drinks a few too many drinks every holiday, it's something we all laugh about later on. And we kind of say, you know, they had a few too many. But if she goes off and she's snorting heroin in the kitchen, well, that's a whole other issue. You cross over into use disorder when there's an impairment in your ability to perform daily tasks, when there's an impairment in terms of your spheres, your global spheres, so your work, your family life, your personal life, where the substance use starts directly impacting those areas. Now we're crossing into use disorder. So if you and I go out and we go to the bar and you have two drinks and you go home and there's no issue and I continue to have three or four drinks or just two and I end up having a DUI and then a few weeks later I have another DUI, now I'm crossing over that boundary because clearly I need to address that. Yeah, what's leading to difficulties for me.
Right.
And that's what I think makes substance use such a difficult thing to define, because you can have two people who can have the same amount of alcohol and one person doesn't have, in general, consistent disruptions in their livelihood where someone else does.
Right.
And obviously the APA and the DSM gets into a lot more categories of this stuff, but I don't want to bug or bug.
Everybody has a different limit.
Well, that's certainly, yeah. And that's part of it in terms of tolerance development is part of their categorization of this. So if we go into the idea of what is substance use and what are individuals who suffer with substance use disorders, you know, the usual conception that we all have is that, you know, you see somebody in their 20s who generally has been, you know, doing things to maintain their substance use lifestyle, so to speak, in terms of theft, in terms of robbing, they even thrown out of the house. Like, but that's a sort of a misconception we have, because generally substance use starts much, much earlier than that point. A lot of the research shows that adolescents and children are more prone to develop substance use disorders, have some certain characteristics in common. For example, children who've lived in either traumatic backgrounds or there was some type of trauma in the home, genetically and biophysiologically tend to have a greater possible predisposition sort of towards developing substance use than a child who didn't come from that background. Furthermore, children with certain temper dysregulation disorders, so you're really kind of kids who have maybe persistent outbursts or very difficult to deal with from a young age, they have a tendency. Now, again, this stuff gets very gray, because what's the difference between a child who has a lot of temper tantrums and a child who has a persistent disorder? There's criteria for it, but even within the criteria, there's area to kind of guess, and it makes them, you know, this person needs, yeah. Which brings me to, you know, sort of the segue I wanted to go into in terms of, you know, what actually happens to an individual physiologically that in terms of substance use. Because I think one of the most frustrating things for family members and for people is that we look at substance users and we say, well, why can't you just stop? One of the things that came up in the research, and again, this is a vein of the research I'd like to go into, there's other obviously different beliefs of abstinence and the need to abstain from all substances and spiritual, and that's a different, but, you know, is this idea of why do certain individuals, why are they more prone to not be able to, why can somebody decide one day, get and say, I don't want to smoke anymore, and that's it. They never seem to, and then someone else will try repeatedly and continue to. Now, in terms of substance use, what starts to really happen with an individual is physiologically in the brain, the substance itself, and some substances are more prone than others to do this. When you use a substance, right, the brain basically has the really rudimentary way to describe it. Sort of, the brain has two parts, right? It has your cortex and it has the limbic system, which is underneath. And the limbic is sort of, so to speak, it's what they call the prehistoric brain. It basically functions on drives. I don't feel good, this feels good, I do this, I sleep, I eat. That's sort of the main function of the limbic system in a simple way. The cortex is your higher level of thinking. It's the part of a brain that makes us say, no, I don't need to buy a $500 watch right now. I need to save that money because I have to do something on my house.
Right.
And the thing is, what happens in the brain is the reward system in the brain, which is our basic fundamental drives come from this reward system. And some of our fundamental drives essentially are, you know, sexual pleasure, eating and breathing, and keeping us alive. And the brain, when the substances come in, that's the area of the brain, it's called the dopaminergic area, so called dopamine. It gets activated by the substances. And for an individual who's more prone to substance use disorder, this activation is, for some people, can be actually more powerful of an impulse than if I don't have, my brain is not predisposed to this, I don't have as strong as a response to someone who is more predisposed to it. So for them, the substance is really pleasurable, or the experience is extremely pleasurable. So now that memory gets logged into place.
This you convince yourself that that's what you need.
And, well, I had a horrible day. My friend took me out for a few drinks. Wow, I felt so much better.
Right.
And now the association is, well, now he's in over. But now these pathways have been laid out prior, somewhere in childhood for the most part, because the child starts to learn there's maladaptive coping skills. We don't learn that I'm really angry. I go in the room, I smash two lamps, and I smash a mirror. Yeah. You know, over time, children learn that you can't do that. You can't go around just breaking things. But there's something that gets, because of the wiring there, and the reward system gets so overwhelming. And over time, this keeps getting repetitive to the brain. You keep doing it, and the brain starts to learn this, and it says, okay, so when I'm stressed, when I'm anxious, I need this to make this go away. And the drive actually starts to direct the person to that, no different than if I'm hungry,
right.
I go to the kitchen, I want to eat. Yeah.
But it might be the easy way out. Because if you weak as a person, you give in.
And that's what I want, you know, part of the thing to talk about, because I think we have this, which has been ingrained for years, even when I was coming up being trained in counseling and theory, there still is a lot of theory that says there is some type of moral lacking for people with substance use disorders. There may be a spiritual lacking for people with substance. Partially that may be true, and people find their paths to recovery in their own ways. But new studies in the neurobiology of addiction is really starting to say there's a lot more to this. There's a really great book, it just came out, actually. It's called Unbroken Brain. I can't think, I'm horrible with names, my own brain disorder. But the author is, she's a known author for Investigative Reporting, and she wrote some other books. But the whole point of the book is sort of this premise. And she perceives substance use disorders as a learning disability, as a developmental disorder. So it's something that starts in childhood and continues to progressively get worse as the person delves into substance use. Because over time, the brain, what happens is people who become habitual substance users and have substance use disorder, they can't process emotions appropriately, like someone who doesn't have a substance use disorder. They show an inability to decrease gratification in their brain. Physically, the actual chemical system and electrical system in the brain can't delay the need for gratification like it could for someone who doesn't have a substance use disorder. It keeps firing and firing and firing, driving the person to almost to the point of literally to compulsion, where you have to satisfy this craving. It's almost no different than if you're starving and you saw food down the road. You're gonna run there, you have water. And as this goes on, the person actually begins to develop an inability to cope in any way of their life without the substance. The substance becomes almost their primary drive. And that's how the beginnings of the neurobiological
independence.
You do. You become, for these people, because their processing on so many levels is impacted. Their emotional processing, their ability to understand in terms of their social world and their social stratosphere, their actual physical drives begin to change. And you definitely see this a lot with opiates and heroin addiction, because the opiate system is so strongly indicated in the reward system of the brain that people, literally the brain begins to rewire itself, where it associates opiates with the same level of necessity as air and oxygen for sustaining the ability to live. And that's when people go through opiate withdrawal, what they refer to as getting dope sick, so to speak. It is so acutely painful for these individuals because literally every fiber of the body is thinking it's dying. Because it's going to be no different. I put you in a room where there's no, I slowly let the oxygen out. The brain then would start to become overwhelmed. So for these individuals, that's what actually happens on the biophysiological level. So when we start to look at it like this, it's not such a simple thing as, well, you know, you lack the ability to get over it. You just need to get over it. Lock yourself in a room for 3 days and get over it. And I think that's one of the things that a lot of prior addiction belief has sort of been built on, this idea that, you know, people hit rock bottom, so to speak, and now, you know, you just have to toughen up, and we give them enough moral development and support, and they go forward. And what it's showing us is that the brain actually has to relearn all these patterns of behavior to take time. And that's part of, we'll come to that part about it, in terms of what does that mean for recovery? What does that mean for treatment? And it's a growing problem. There's a growing problem. So in terms of the substance use in the individual, we know now that they actually begin to develop an inability, besides it's physiological, then also their social part of their brain begins to develop an inability how to cope, how to understand the world without the substance. They can't manage things. So now we take a person, for example, we put them in detox, and we get them physiologically off the substance, and I'll talk about the difference between detox and rehab. So we get them physically off the substance. They're no longer physically addicted, so to speak, in terms of they're not withdrawing actively. Then maybe we put them in a rehab. And in the rehab, we expect this person who, for the last maybe 5, 10, 15 years, for whatever reason, has been unable to deal with social situations and has over time turned to the substance to be able to manage social anxiety. Now we throw them in these groups and say, talk about your most intimate issues, your most serious fears about the points in your life that were the absolute worst. And talk to these group of people about them. And by the way, you don't have any substances anymore to rely on to get you through this. And then these people go and they're overwhelmed, and their brain is overwhelmed because it's never learned coping strategies to deal with these things other than over time, I take the substance, now I can talk to you. I can take a few pills, now I can talk to you calmly about these issues. So it's relearning this whole social piece of it for them, which is very difficult. And actually getting the brain to literally sort of rewire itself. And it's interesting, some of the findings and have found that people who are prone to substance use disorders have a low threshold. Their actual reward system begins to get blunted over time. And they require a larger stimulus, so to speak, to have pleasure or enjoyment. So for example, someone who might ride a bike down a hill, the next time needs a bigger hill to ride their bike down, and a bigger hill to ride their bike down, where someone else says, I'm fine with this one hill, and it makes me happy. So these people begin to crave novelty to get any sense of pleasure. And all of a sudden, they enter into this world of substance, and obviously the substance itself, especially certain ones, MDMA, opiates, heroin, have this sort of euphoric effect to them. Now, we'll get into a whole other class in a few minutes, but... And then on top of that becomes this whole sort of lifestyle that begins to change when the person starts to change. So things previously like work and family start to erode because of the abuse and the issue and what comes around it. And people inevitably start to find people of similar interest with them. And that becomes, you hear this a lot with, especially with heroin, people having ongoing issues and struggles with heroin. They'll talk about the lifestyle that, you get up and eventually it progresses to a point because it's about physical sickness, but prior to that, the lifestyle of getting up in the morning and the chase of finding the drug and how to make and get the substance and then use the substance. And there's this whole buildup that is in itself enjoyable for the person. So when we just say, okay, we'll just take your substance away, well, now the person says, well, what do? I don't know anything else. Aside from just the enjoyment of using it, my whole lifestyle has been built around this now. So it's interesting in terms of like you talk about having it there in terms of like alcohol and then right. There's no age, there's not maybe not a novelty associated right. with it. Now there's a lot of different theories of why is this becoming a bigger issue now. There's all types of theories. You see higher increases in terms of diagnostics of children and adolescents with different types of the terminology used, any mental illness, AMI they call it, or severe mental illness. So kids who have anxiety disorders, depression, kids who have impulse control disorders, ADHD is a strong co-occurrence of ADHD and young diagnosis of ADHD and further developing of substance use.
Even Asperger's?
I didn't see that specifically, and that's a curious question because I don't know anything in terms of the correlation between Asperger's or autism spectrum and substance use. I've never read anything on that. So we have some new, not really new, but they're newer in terms of being used, classes of drugs. So now you're starting to see a lot, your rise in what they call synthetics or analogs, new psychoactive substances are calling them. And these are your bath salts. These are your synthetic cannabinoids or synthetic marijuana. Now, and also in some cases, your Molly and even your MDMA and your ecstasy. Now, they're all kind of getting mixed in. And what you're having with these, the broader umbrella term is called cathinones, which are basically derivatives of the cat plant, which is sort of a stimulant plant down, I think it's in South America. But these are made in labs, and you're having a rise of a whole new drug culture in terms of there's a lot of people who apparently have advanced chemistry degrees who couldn't find work or got kicked out of the chemistry field, and now are making this stuff at home in their basements and selling it to the general public.
And their houses are blowing up, and we see it on the news.
Yeah. ERs are starting to really get run over with these. And it's a whole new world in terms of use, and a lot of urine tox screens don't pick them up in terms of possible urine tox screens have to be sent out for more specific testing. But they're actually starting, you're seeing a bit of an uptick, and they're classifying as hallucinogens in drug use in 18 to 30-year-olds, because these are readily available online. You can order them. I can go online and order them today, and they'll be at my house, because it's technically not illegal, because they keep changing the chemistry to make this. So the chemicals get outlawed, and the guys come up with a different combination. The chemicals, which therefore they come. So that leaves a question of, you know, what do we do when we have an individual who is suffering with a substance use disorder? I mean, it is over time an insidious thing in that it pulls down and really breaks apart families over a period of time. And it's multi-generational. I mean, nowadays more so than in previous times, right? Families are living together in terms of adult children returning back home because of obviously financial strains. They may have grandchildren with them. And someone in the family has a substance use disorder, and you see this ripple effect across the family. And what starts to happen is when someone is struggling with a substance use disorder in a family, they become sort of, there's a family systems theory. So we look at a family as a whole, and each one of us plays a role in this family. And over time, we begin to, even unconsciously, we just fulfill this role. So my role might be the protector, your role might be the rule breaker, your role might be the moderator who wants everything. You know, naturally we start to fill these. And when we have someone with a substance use disorder, they generally get pegged as what they call the identified patient, because there's a lot of chaos around substance use over time. The person, you know, stops going to school, they become destructive at home, they become more defiant, they start maybe stealing things. And with that, a lot of the negativity of the family, other issues that are going on in the family start to get driven towards that person, because we start to say, if it wasn't for you doing this, then this wouldn't be happening. You know, we wouldn't be arguing, even though there's no substance use here, but because you're using substances, we start to triangulate, and the person really becomes this identified patient, and we tend to hurl all these sort of negatives at them. And it's a difficult thing. I mean, there's a lot of, you know, over the years, been a lot of literature in terms of terms like denial with family and enabling with families. You know, I don't particularly like those terminology, because I think, you know, it's a lot more complicated than just locking somebody in the house and telling them I'm not going to give you any money anymore. Mm-hmm. If it was that simple, we wouldn't have a substance use issue. Everybody would recover. So to work with families and substance use, to see the language that we're using, how we engage. I mean, I can tell you there's a lot of families I've spoken to in the ER when I really talked to them about, well, what has been the engagement that you've had with your child about substance? Well, you know, I gave them some websites to look up, and we talked that they shouldn't use any drugs. Okay, well, there was some discussion. But did you sit down with them and talk to them about what their understanding of substance is? What are their friends' understanding of substance? What is the environment they're in right now? Are their friends using substances? I mean, I think it's something like 45% of people over the age of 20 or 25 have used some type of illicit substance at some point in their life. So that's, you know, one out of two kids are going to eventually use something during that period of time. So are we talking to them openly about this? Are we having dialogues about, you know, I've seen kids who said, you know, I told my parents I use marijuana, and the family explodes. And I can sympathize with the family, because the fear is this going to progress into something much worse? Sure. But then if we just automatically explode, now we've cut off communication. Now the child or adolescent feels shamed, feels frightened. I'll keep this to myself. I don't want to disappoint the family. And as the substance use disorder continues to progress, the internal message the person takes away is, I'm a disappointment. I am the loser in the family. I'm the one making everything worse. They already have this impacted or sort of impaired brain in terms of perceiving and processing the world. And now the substance becomes the sole thing that makes it better. I have these horrible feelings about myself. I go in and take the substance and I can check out for 4 hours and life is okay. And then I go back. Now, that's not to say the family's at fault for substance use. Substance use
is... So the family needs counseling.
Exactly. That's my personal belief. I tend to believe in a family system approach to treatment of substance use. Other people say no. That's not that it hurts, but that's not, they're going to say that's not the primary.
Seems like it's very necessary.
I think it's, we look at it, it's such a complex disorder. And it surprisingly, it has the most highest recovery rate of any type of mental illness. If someone's schizophrenic, they generally don't recover, unfortunately. They will have schizophrenia and acuity for the rest of their life. If someone has severe bipolar disorder, they will have that the rest of their life. Substance use disorders, people who struggle with them can recover. They can move forward. Now, they'll always have to be on guard for potential setbacks, but there is a recovery rate there. So most people don't exist in vacuums, so at some point we need to work with whatever their family system is. It could be friends, it could be a biological family, adoptive family, supportive family. But if we don't address the issue as a whole, you know, if we take someone, we put them in a detox, we want to know, we want to say, well, you know, when did you start
right.
using opiates?
Right.
How did that happen?
How did that happen, exactly?
And you'll hear repeatedly, I tell you, and I believe people, I know a lot of people say, well, substance users, addicts lie. They lie about everything. There's a lot of deceptive behavior, there is, because there's a need to get what you need. But a lot of people lately with the opiate crisis and heroin crisis will tell you, I started out, I got hurt, I started out going to the doctor, and the doctor had good intention, I want to treat your pain, I can see you're in agony. And then what's slowly built into, I started buying Percocet or Vicodin on the street. Well, the going rate on those is exceptionally expensive. You're talking hundreds of dollars for a few pills, maybe three or four. You have an abuse pattern of 40 or 50 pills a day, you're talking thousands of dollars a day. Eventually you run into most people, individuals on the money. You come along and say, well, tell you what, Save a few of these for $5 a bag. And now we develop. But I think in the research I saw, the tendency to go down into that pathway started much sooner, and something that the person probably won't be able to recognize definitively. They won't be able to say, well, I remember that my mother hit me with a frying pan when I was 6 years old, and and I don't know if it's even that simple.
No.
To say that, because then of course then the joke with Freud is it's always mom's fault, right? Everything in life is mom's fault. Five people who can use cocaine, and only one or two of them will have an addiction, a substance abuse issue. The other three won't. They'll never have. And there's certain people that can go intermittently their whole life. Oh, that's one. That's right. The same problem. I always think my phone's off, and when I want it off, it rings.
You should become addicted because you have more money. You have money to buy. Stuff is not cheap.
Well, see, I think that's the thing. In terms of, like, for example, opiate addicts especially, right? Heroin is exceptionally cheap. The market, especially, part of the reason New Jersey is so problematic.
The synthetic, the one that's not that good. I mean, the one that's going to kill you, that's cheap.
Well, that's one of them. Now we have the issue with the fentanyl. Now the new one, which they're issuing alerts out, is
make
carfentanil, which is the one that's been associated with a rash of overdose deaths.
Right.
It's actually a tranquilizer for elephants.
I guess they just don't realize how potent it is, how many times stronger than heroin it is.
I think what happens is, for the most part, is that the dealers or the distributors who are selling this stuff are cutting it in
rat
poison.
Because
all kinds of stuff.
Yeah, rat poison.
Yeah, well, if I can get fentanyl and I'm a dealer, and most of the dealers, they stamp their packages, so you know. So, because most users will know, red top, for example, is much better than yellow top. So I'm going to go back to you because you have the red top.
What country it comes from.
It's no different than Walmart and Target and these guys. It's the same. So if I get a package of fentanyl, I can cut it into my heroin. My high is going to be much better for you. Now, maybe the person who cut it didn't pay attention. They put a little too much in.
Right.
You don't know when you get it. I mean,
that's
I don't necessarily think people are.
Well, that's why we have our Narcan kits.
Well, that's it, people. But they're showing now. I mean, there was an article recently about someone with carfentanil who they hit the person up 6 or 7 times and she was still unresponsive.
Because
it binds so strongly with the opiate receptors that naltrexone can't get in there and actually pull it out. And it's really becoming a scare because now this carfentanil is really starting to rush the streets along with the fentanyl. It's already starting to cause a lot of deaths. I think most individuals who overdose, the intention isn't to overdose. Anybody who's gone out to a Christmas party or any other party, had a few too many to drink, one day you can have 2 glasses of wine and wake up the next morning and feel horrible, and another time you get 3 glasses and you wake up and you're fine.
Right.
Depending on your physiology that day, your metabolism that day, what you mean. But I think, it's an issue in terms of the newer, more potent, you're seeing more potent strains of everything. Marijuana, the THC quality is much higher than concentrations now. I mean, we used to be 6% and 5% back in the 70s and 80s. Now you're hitting strains that are hitting 13% and 14% of THC. So you're starting to see individuals now who are abusing regular marijuana, so to speak, and they're starting to cross over into that hallucinogenic portion, which THC is a hallucinogen, but
that's
low
why
dose.
I'd like to see 5 years from now where we're at with Colorado with all this marijuana.
Yeah. Studies out of Amsterdam was actually that drug use increased when you made the market open for people. I don't know if abuse in terms of dependence increased, but definitely overall people felt more comfortable going in. And one of the reasons why MDMA and Molly and that is increasing is because the general idea is that it's a safe drug. Because it was born in clubs initially in the 80s into the 90s. And a lot of the 18 to 30 range, especially 18 to 25, are starting to use it because they're saying, well, heroin, I don't want to do heroin. I see what's happening to people. I don't want to touch other opiates. I don't want to do really cocaine. People, Molly is safe. It's a safe drug, but it's not. And actually, some of the more concentrated doses of Molly, which Molly used to be a pure form of MDMA without the, there's a chemical compound that gets left out, so it doesn't have the additives, so it's a much more pure high, so to speak. And it makes you feel euphoric, it makes you feel very energetic, it increases arousal, it increases sensation. But now the addictive quality is much higher. In addition, a lot of them now are being mixed with the synthetic catechones that are causing all types of issues. So, but again, this is an education piece. This is where sitting and talking with kids and with family about these things and dispelling that idea of what a safe drug is and what does that mean. And part of this is working with someone's motivation. I mean, a lot of times with people with addiction, I see families come in all the time to ERs and they say, we just gotta lock them up. Well, I mean, unfortunately, first of all, legally I can't. New Jersey does not have a law right now in terms of commitment for substance use. Massachusetts does, they put it in the works years ago because their opiate crisis was growing and it's still an epic up there. But you can commit someone in Massachusetts for substance use. New Jersey, we cannot. As much as we might want to, want to help the family, we can't do it. We have to let the person go. But with that goes back to my last piece, and I don't want to go too far over, but the idea of what is our treatment modalities right now? Detox, generally a detox is when we put somebody in to get physically off of the dependence of the substance. So if it's opiates, we detox them off the opiates so they don't go through an acute withdrawal sickness. If it's alcohol and benzodiazepines, we withdraw them safely. Because alcohol and benzodiazepines can kill you. Withdrawal from that can actually kill you. Withdrawal from opiates cannot, in general sense. Because actually, when you go through withdrawal from benzos and alcohol, benzodiazepines, your Ativans, your Xanax, your Valiums, they can cause a hypertensive crisis leading to heart attack or stroke. Opiate withdrawal feel like you're dying. People will be in agony, but generally, unless they have some type of underlying issue, they won't die from the withdrawal. But detox is relatively short. If it's severe alcoholism, maybe it's 7 days, maybe 10. Opiates, with insurance, maybe they're giving you 5-6 days maximum. Then if you're lucky enough, you get moved over to a rehab program.
Wait, what is the definition of detox? That removal of the substance from the system?
Essentially, the physiological addiction is now no longer present. So without the substance, if it's opiates, you won't get sick. You won't go through opiate withdrawal. So, how do we see somebody in opiate withdrawal? What are your telltale signs? Early on, your telltale sign may be increased itchiness, a lot of yawning. As it progresses, you might see more diaphragmatic sweating. The person may, the eyes will tend to start to dilate. As you're talking about abdominal cramping and pain, aches, almost like flu-like symptoms. Then you might start seeing some real sort of gastrointestinal issues that begin to develop and continue. You'll hear about a lot of pain and agony in terms of that, because the body literally is all the pain centers in the body are just overwhelmed. Because, the more you use opiates, the more you put any substance in the body, the brain modifies itself to deal with it. So if we put opiates in, we have opiate receptors because the idea is that there's pain receptors in the body. Body has these pain receptors to tell us if we did something wrong. I put my hand on the stove, I hurt myself, I know I take my hand off. If I don't have those receptors, I keep my hand on the stove and I set myself ablaze. So the more we use the opiate, the brain compensates by growing more pain receptors. It says, oh, there's not enough of these, I don't feel any pain. So when you take the opiate away from the person, all those receptors are wide open now. And that's why, one of these things where you see why the relapse is so high, especially with heroin and opiates, is because it is so overwhelming. The brain, some studies have shown the brain needs a year to rewire itself. a year of complete no substance use. We put people in detox to get them off the physical addiction, and gives them 5-6 days. Now they're left in a world where, okay, well, maybe we put them in outpatient 3 days a week, but they're in a world now where their social world has been completely robbed of them. The life they were living with other people or whatever the lifestyle was of chasing a substance is in theory we're trying to keep them away, so that's gone. The life they had before, maybe a year or 2 years or 5 years ago, is a distant memory. Their ability to socialize and interact with the world is severely hampered because they've learned for the last 5 years, my way of dealing and interacting with the world is under the influence of the substance. So we take this person, we, here you go, we'll see you in group next week. And again, come to group and tell me about how you were, you know, molested as a child, and we'll be all right. We'll talk about that. So, I mean, it's unfortunate. I mean,
well, how long is rehab? Detox, maybe 5-7 days. Then they go to rehab for how long?
Depending. So if you're lucky and get into rehab, some of them are 14 days, some are 28.
That's not enough.
If you are an individual who has great insurance or a family who is well-funded, you can go to one of the longer-term, nicer. A lot of people who recover just do so by natural progression of time. And the associated theory is once people hit 30, a lot of substance use starts to tail off. And part of the reason is the brain at that point, now we know, has been fully developed. The executive function, the cortex, the frontal area has fully developed. And that's the part of the brain that tells us stop. Stop eating so much. That's not, I don't need that extra cookie.
You're talking
about moderation.
Right.
I can only
the
have
18
one.
To 25-year-old group, you said, which is the largest group.
You know, not developed. Yeah, the brain, that's, and that's where you're seeing, this. And for some of them, it turns off. They hit 30, and all of a sudden, for no rhyme or reason that we can say definitively in terms of research. But for a lot of people who recovered, it's because they found something else in terms of you mentioned before about family. They've had a child, their parent gets sick, and they say, okay, all of a sudden I have something else to grab onto. Mm-hmm. But even with that, it's not a definitive, that's it. You know, I think this idea, a lot of the treatment modalities that are out there, this is my opinion, are based in a system of belief that was a lot of the idea of abstinence, the idea that you have to just quit, you have to have abstinence, you have to find some other level of integration, and that's great. But I don't think it addresses the biology piece of it. And I don't want to just negate substance use down to biology because it's not. It's so complex, it's on all levels, and that's what makes it such a difficult disorder. But I do think we need more. I mean, I think that the level of treatment right now that's out there, getting people into detoxes or rehabs, unfortunately, they're overrun. Especially for individuals who either have no insurance or limited financial, they're extremely overrun.
So what's the answer?
I don't think we found it just yet. We're still looking. You know, I think we have to, even as mental health professionals, we have to start looking at the way we conceptualize substance use and the way we treat these individuals. And even for us, that stigma. Because I can tell you in the ER, and I've been guilty of it in the past too, a long night in the ER, someone comes in and the primary complaint is, you know, benzo dependence, and I'm like, all right, you know, let me go. Because I know fundamentally, there's not much I can offer you from the emergency room setting. I can talk to you about it. I'm probably not going to be able to get you into a detox realistically, depending on what type of insurance plan you have and the waiting list of the detoxes. Mm-hmm. And even then, I'm just handing you off and passing you on to somebody else. And personally, I've met a lot of CADCs, Certified Alcohol Drug Counselors, who come from a very previous model of belief. For some people, it works. For some people, it doesn't work in terms of the people they're working with. So I think we need to keep looking at this problem. I don't think it's a definitive answer, but I think the state needs to do more. They put a lot of money in. They create a lot of hotlines. That's great. It's a great starting point, but I'm not hearing more. If you're 18 to 25, you're at that aging out period, especially 25 and up, of you can't be covered by your parents' insurance unless you're in school. There is the Affordable Care Act. Some people don't qualify, some people don't apply. Especially if someone whose primary mode is, I have to get the substance. They're not going to go down and fill out a 15-page application online somewhere at healthcare exchange. And the Medicaid is good, but it really limits, obviously, the other facilities you don't have waiting lists don't take Medicaid, definitively. They'll try and help refer someone somewhere, but it's an ongoing issue. So I think it's something that, I don't have a definitive answer.
Is there any kind of research that they're doing in this field?
There's a lot of research. I think part of it is that it's still somewhat, and obviously some neurologists will be able to speak about this better, but it's still somewhat in its infancy in terms of, okay, we're just starting to understand how it works, and then once we can kind of understand how it works, maybe there's something we can develop to try and help this along. The problem, I think, is because the brain is adaptive, unlike most other organs, right? If your thyroid's not functioning, right, it should not function for a reason. We try to figure out the reason. If it's a, you know, growth, and we cut the growth out and hope. But the brain is constantly adaptive. So if we, if I do X, Y, and Z every day for 4 years to the brain, that part of the brain develops, another part of the brain prunes itself out. And then, and vice versa. So it's not as straightforward, I think, and that's part of the difficulty. I also think there's a great deal of conflict in the field in terms of these sort of things, of money, of researchers. You know, what does this prove? I think they're moving in that direction. The neural studies in the last 10 years are fascinating. You can read tons of articles on them, and they're just coming out constantly. Most of these articles I'm referencing are within 2006 to now, which sound 10 years sounds like a lot, but in terms of research, it's like nothing. I mean, so I think we're getting there. But to give you an example, like years ago, they've been talking about with people who suffer acute treatment-resistant depression. They found in studies that they put an electrode in a certain part deep in the limbic system and activate it, actually alleviates the depression. We're still not doing that regularly. They still haven't found a way to regularly do this for people. And yet it's been in the research for years. So I think they're moving in that direction. And I think these new studies are fascinating in terms of finding, there's so many overlapping similarities in terms of some of these early childhood disorders. And the same thing as substance users have. And how the, you know, now they're saying there is these sort of, but I think you're right. I mean, there's a whole bunch of research on attachment issues from childbirth on that can lead down the road. Attachment theory is not my specialty by any means, but my wife is a big attachment person. So I mean, there's all types. So I think because this is what makes substance use so complex and difficult to treat, because it is a disorder truly on every single level. You know, biologically, physiologically, socially, contextually, and it all compresses together and just creates a really difficult problem. And it's not, and we have all of this idea that it's just simple as just stop. I think with something like an ADHD, it's difficult, and this goes to tie into the whole point, I'll sum this up, is sort of the idea that, you know, we take this child who's maybe 7 or 8 and having these sort of disruptive behaviors, right? The suspected theory is ADHD. Now, there's no definitive test for ADHD. There's questionnaires and there's symptoms that we look at. Now, if you really look at these symptoms, a lot of them are very great in terms of most adolescent child are going to be, you know, compulsiveness, inattentiveness, hyperactivity. Especially a lot of male children are going to meet this criteria. Now, that doesn't mean there aren't kids that definitively have. But with that, are we sitting with the family sometimes who may be overwhelmed? The family might have 2 or 3 children, one who has definitive special needs that we know about. One, and the family's overwhelmed, and I think you're right, they go to the pediatrician because they trust the doctor, and I think the doctor's intent is to do well.
I think it's a very quick thing,
and you're right. I think you know, it's with some of these kids at ADHD who don't get the proper treatment, or even then once they get the medication, what else are we doing, though, to address? That's the part that I think that's where you see, and you see that with substance use disorder individuals, that there was something pattern on. The other thing, too, is that most people with substance use disorders, if you go back in the family history, someone in the family who had a substance use disorder, it was definitively known or spoken about, but there was something there. And that, there's a whole other area of research that, you know, obviously, if you have someone who abuses a substance in the house, the propensity for, especially for children to develop a substance use, goes up exponentially. And some are more associated hereditary in terms of genetics, and some are not. Some are learned. So it really shows a sort of bridging of both. But I think you're right. I think early intervention programs have helped.
I have a quick question, actually.
Yeah.
You talk about the medical approach to treating like opiate addiction.
Yeah.
What are your thoughts on using like opiate blockers? I've heard of Suboxone, I think it's called.
I mean, Suboxone is interesting. So Suboxone is like a newer version of sort of an opiate maintenance. So initially, the older version of treatment was methadone. Methadone's still around, right? We put somebody on methadone, we give them a dose that over time, a long period of time, we slowly lower it so the person doesn't go through acute opiate withdrawal. Suboxone is sort of similar. It can be done on an outpatient basis. It maintains the person from getting ill. Now, I think the issue, just like methadone, it has benefits and it has withdrawals. I think some people can do, have done really well on it. They don't return to constant ongoing heroin or opiate abuse, and the Suboxone maintains them, and over time they taper it down, depending on who their physician is or working with.
Some people begin to abuse Suboxone in high doses, and other doses you can actually abuse Suboxone. And for some people, you know, depending on their prescriber, it can lead to its own host of issues. So I think, again, it's sort of what works for an individual. I think some individuals work better with that sort of step-down situation or that tapering off, whereas other individuals may need something, you know, more like a detox straight through. And I think in a way Suboxone is good because it sort of allows a person a chance to, if it's done properly, allows a person a chance to readapt their brain. They're not just going from having a substance to no substance whatsoever, because the Suboxone can sort of fill some of those receptors without leaving the person completely devoid of anything. They're not necessarily under the influence or not. They're not intoxicated. It doesn't leave them just devoid of any substance. So I think it has its place. I think it works for, you know, different people. I don't think it's a bad thing. Obviously, it gets a bad rap. Just like anything, though. Anything you try, eventually someone's going to find an angle around it. I mean, you know, people will find anything in terms of things. I mean, opioid users are, you know, using Benadryl and using Colace is another one that you can use with opiates to avoid high doses of Colace, which is obviously a stool softener. It can be abused. I would never want to do that, but there's a way to find your way around it. So, I mean, I think there's always going to be a workaround, but I think if it works for people, I think it's a good thing. I think it gives people some different options. I think a lot of people don't like it, and that goes back to that sort of idea that you just need to be off substances, abstinence. I think it has its place, but not for everyone. So, yeah.